Welcome to the library, not usually open on Sunday. This is a special event, as you know. And the reason that we're all here is to honor Janice Bohanowitz. And one of her wishes was to create a fund that at least partially would benefit the Greenfield Public Library, and money would pass through the Friends and determine how that would be spent in Janice's honor, honoring her wishes and her interest in reading, and et cetera, et cetera. She was a great friend of the library, great friend of what this library does for the Greenfield community and what it does for surrounding towns. And those of you who are here today are really honoring her by buying raffle tickets, because that money will help out what Janice wished to help out. As you all know, we are planning a new library, in the active stages of doing that. And we only wish that Janice could be here because we hope that that library will answer all of what her wishes would have been for a library in the future. So that's one of our great hopes. Let me just say a few words about our speaker today. Peter Bergeron, Janice's son, has been involved in baseball since early childhood. He went through the Greenfield minor league, school baseball, of course. Interesting, kids, I want you to listen to this carefully. Not only was he a star in athletics, both football and baseball, but he was also a star in the classroom. Valedictorian of the class in high school?
Definitely was a valedictorian.
Okay.
I'd say ranked like 10.
Okay, so he was ranked in the top 10 people in the class when he graduated from high school. So just think about athletics with respect to studies too when you're in school. Pete worked his way through the minor leagues, and finally, yes, a Greenfield guy actually made the major leagues and played with the Montreal Expos. So it's my pleasure to introduce Peter Bergeron, who is now a professional scout for the Los Angeles Dodgers. Peter?
I just want to thank everybody for coming out. We really didn't know what type of crowd or who would come out just to talk a little baseball and like Terry said, honor my mom. The library was something very special to my mom, and with her passing, she wanted to kind of leave something to the library. More importantly, I think just to instill upon her grandkids just how important education was and how important reading was to her. And the support that has been given, you know, with the road race that was held in her honor, with the bar shootout, now with the raffle tickets here, it's been overwhelming to me and our family, the kind of support that you guys have shown. So I really appreciate all that. But I was asked to come today just to talk a little baseball, to give an insight on my journey up to the major leagues and beyond that, and talk a little bit about what I do today, which is professional scouting with the Los Angeles Dodgers. And as the sun is shining and it feels like baseball weather and it's opening day, and which is all great, but I know once you kind of look past and see the snow on the ground, it's a little different feel. But hopefully they'll get the game in tomorrow in Boston. I don't know how much snow they ended up getting or what their field looks like, but I know the Red Sox are supposed to open up tomorrow night against Pittsburgh, or tomorrow afternoon. But just a quick backstory. There's so many familiar faces in the room. Hopefully I'm not boring you with my story, but like Terry said, I went to Greenfield schools. Baseball was always my favorite sport, but I also played basketball and football. And for those young kids in the audience today and that might hear this after it's said and done, I really recommend playing other sports. I wouldn't have had it any other way just to concentrate on one sport. I think coaches sometimes are jealous and they want you to concentrate on their sport only that they coach, but I really recommend practicing other sports, playing other sports, being involved in other things, and not just, you know, specific to one thing, just because, just kind of like life, you know, same way, you know, if you get your head down, just one goal, one thing the whole time, and don't open yourself up to other people and other opportunities, you never know what you might miss. And tying that back to how my mom was and how she lived her life, she had so many different groups, you know, and it was evident after her passing were, you know, family and friends, but then she had her reading group and she had her ski group and she had her running group, and I'm gonna leave out other groups that she had, but she truly just, you know, really broadened her life to open it up to so many people. And the same can be said where, you know, sports were a big part of my life, but like Terry said, education was also something that was very important, that should be very important to all of you. And join other groups, you know, play an instrument, go to theater class, you know, broaden your life and really reach out to as many different things as you can. But getting back to me, in my journey, playing high school ball was, you know, I always put baseball first, but I played other sports, but baseball was something that allowed me to travel to Japan when I was in high school, and some of you may have remembered that. I reached out to the community to try to help me raise some money for a trip to Japan after my junior year of high school, and that was something that, you know, is still something very memorable to me today. I was allowed by my parents to drive to Euclid, Ohio, in the summer by myself, you know, before cell phones or anything else. I remember getting, you know, here I am, getting into the car, driving up to Ohio to attend a baseball tournament. And, you know, at that baseball tournament, I was discovered by Clemson University, had scouts there, and they were recruiting that summer. And that kind of led to a scholarship opportunity at Clemson University. For those of you who didn't know, that I signed to go there for college on a baseball scholarship. And just real quick, and I'm just going to kind of go off on tangents as I'm talking, but real quick how that works. Baseball scholarships, it wasn't a full scholarship. If someone says they have a full scholarship in baseball, they're either lying or they're very, very good. Because baseball scholarships are very hard to get to. There's 11 for the whole team. And so you do the numbers, there's more than 11 players on a baseball team, but you get, like, I think it's 11.7 baseball scholarships for the whole team. So they're kind of given out as partial scholarships. You know, you might get 50%, you might get 30%, you know, and I don't remember exactly what my percent was, but it certainly wasn't a full scholarship to go to Clemson University. But I was going to go to Clemson. I kind of fell in love with the campus. I fell in love with the program. I signed to go play baseball, which wouldn't allow me to play football. If you're on a baseball scholarship, you can't play football. If you are on a football scholarship, you can play baseball. And that just goes back to football is king at all these universities. They get X amount of scholarships, which is quite a few, but they don't want them trying to get even more by putting people on a baseball scholarship and then playing football, so you have to do it the other way around. But I was going to go to Clemson University. When the June draft came along after my senior year, I was drafted by the Los Angeles Dodgers in the fourth round, and I had a big decision to make, whether to go pursue my dream as a professional baseball player or go to Clemson University. And a funny story is, right after I was drafted, Coach Leggett, he was down at Clemson University, and he just retired, you know, a couple years ago, and he called me up, and he was like, you know, congratulations on getting drafted. You know, that's quite an honor. The Los Angeles Dodgers, that's quite an organization. Well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to call them up and say, you know, thanks for drafting me, but you got an opportunity down here at Clemson University that you just can't pass up. And, you know, so certainly, you know, that goes on. And the pressure that involved at these high school kids, you know, leading up to even the decision on college, you know, phone calls that I was getting for football and baseball to come to the university, the travels that I got to take, as far as, you know, I got to go to Notre Dame football game because I was getting recruited by Notre Dame in baseball. I was supposed to do the Midnight Madness at Kentucky for their basketball program because I was getting recruited by Kentucky. I had a football game that Friday night I couldn't attend, but I ended up taking a visit there. So, like, all these opportunities were, you know, there's all this pressure, and now here I am with a baseball offer on one hand for the Los Angeles Dodgers, a scholarship to Clemson to go down and play there. It was a no lose situation in my, you know, on my side, but I chose to go the professional baseball route. And it was fly to Florida to Vero Beach, get assigned to a team, fly out to Yakima, Washington, where I spent my first professional season. And along the way, I had many visitors come out and see me. You know, I gave my family a place to go each year, depending on what team I was assigned to. There wasn't really, it wasn't a take a summer trip to here, summer trip there, it's take a summer trip to wherever Peter's playing that year. So I think they had fun, and I'm gonna try to name all the places that baseball's taking me. So the first year I was in Yakima, Washington. At the end of that season, I was fortunate enough to get called up to Savannah, Georgia for their playoffs. So we won a championship in Yakima, Washington. I then won a championship by playing two games for Savannah Sandnats in 1996. So a player got hurt, they needed a center fielder, they're already in the middle of their thing, so I joined their team for two games. Then it brought me to Arizona for instructional league, and that's year one. So you think about all the places that I went in the first year, it's certainly, you know, quite a journey. That first season, I made $800 a month. So I worked 2.5 months. You do the math. You know, like I said, it's not very glamorous as far as you know, the money that can be made at the major leagues is very high, but it's a long road to get up to where those select few are. My second year brought me to Savannah, Georgia. And then I was fortunate enough at the end of that year to get called up to the San Bernardino for their playoffs. We didn't make playoffs in Savannah, but I got called up. So you can see, like, as far as, you know, different things happen as far as being able to jump around in the minor leagues. Just because you're on a certain team to start the season, there's a lot of up and down that goes on. You guys hear about the Red Sox teams, and if you're really involved, you'll know some of the Pawtucket players, because those are guys going up and down. But they have Portland underneath them, Salem, Greenville. They have Lowell, Mass, which is a short season team, and then they have the Gulf Coast. And within all those teams, they're shuffling guys up and down to fill their rosters. And then there's a pool of people at the very bottom that are waiting to try to get on one of those teams before it all happens again in the June draft and 40 new players come in. So it certainly is something that, unless you're a true baseball fan, you don't really know the ins and outs of what's going on kind of underneath. Getting back to my story, that next year I went to San Antonio, Texas. I was on their team, and then in July I was traded to the Montreal Expos organization. So I went from AA with LA to AA with Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, which belonged to the Montreal Expos. That year we won another championship. So three seasons, two full years in, I've already had three championship rings, thinking this is pretty easy. But that's all the rings that I actually won through my whole career that happened in the first couple years. From there, I went to the Arizona Fall League, which is an extra league after the season's done. Some of you might have heard of Arizona Fall League. Now they play it on TV, on the MLB network. It's a select few from each organization. They go together. We were a team of the NL East teams, usually got three position players, three pitchers from each team. They kind of combine this, you know, combine the divisions to come up with another team, just play some extra games. And then the following year, it was back to Harrisburg, which I thought was the end of the world, because here I am repeating a level. At the time, I was young. I was told that they were kind of protecting me, and they truly were. AAA is a roster full of half the people are on their way up and really still hungry, really have a passion for the game. Half the people are on their way down. They think they belong in the big leagues. Their attitude isn't always jolly, day in and day out. And so I was told they were kind of protecting me from that half that's not always jolly type of thing. And at the time, I'm 20, 21 years old, 21 I think at that year, I didn't understand. I was mad about going back, but it all worked out, because halfway through that season, I moved up to AAA, which is Ottawa. I was there for a couple months, and then made my major league debut in September of 99. So I made it up really quick. I stayed with Montreal until 04. I was kind of up and down. Some highlights that I had during during those years was got to play a series at Fenway Park. Fenway Park was a park that you all know just because living in Massachusetts is something, you know, definitely the park that was larger than life for me growing up. And to be in the visitor's dugout, you know, dressing in the locker room, going out, having people yell at me, fans yell at me saying, you know, go back to Canada, and being able to yell back, I'm from Massachusetts, was something very special to me, and was something, you know, pretty humorous as far as what I just told you. You know, everybody assumed because we're the Montreal Expos that we were all from Canada, that we're all Canadians. We maybe had one Canadian on the team. So what's that?
Hey there now.
Yeah, right. So, you know, the baseball locker room is definitely all different nationalities. It's a big melting pot of all different countries and all different players. And it's just funny, you know, going around and, you know, being identified where, you know, they're Boston Red Sox. I mean, how many of them are really from Boston? I'd have to look at the roster to see if there's any. But we as fans, we kind of identify with them and they're ours. And the same was true with kind of Montreal. Like, hey, you know, you guys are from Montreal, get out of our city. But it was just kind of a humorous note getting yelled at by them. But going from Montreal, I was then traded to the Milwaukee Brewers organization. I played in Indianapolis for a season. After that, I signed with the Philadelphia organization. I played with them for a season. I went to independent ball in the Atlantic League. I played in Nashville, New Hampshire, and I also played in York, Pennsylvania. Trivia question: I was the first player ever to be signed by York. So it's a you know, one of those questions that is out there, but I don't think anybody. I wouldn't expect anybody to actually know the answer. But where else has it brought me? I played in Altoona Curve. Double-A Pirates was the last team I played for. I got a broken bat hit my very last at bat, and to keep on playing, I was trying to, you know, I wanted to play for as long as I could, but I kind of saw the writing on the walls when I was making some phone calls to people and asking for a spot on their roster, asking for an invite to spring training, and I was getting, like, you know, we have a coaching opening, you know, my reputation was good as far as in the clubhouse and working with people, but at the time, I felt like I still wanted to play. But I kind of saw that it was time to move on, you know, do something else. I wasn't ready to be a coach at the time, just because I had had coaches in the past, still thought that they should be playing, and I didn't want to be that coach. I truly, once I made the decision to be a coach, I wanted to be invested in them, not invested in myself. And at the time, I knew that I'd still be invested in myself in some way. So I took a step back. Part of my contract with the LA Dodgers, because that's the team that drafted me, was that they would pay for school whenever I was ready to use my college education money. And so I moved to Georgia. I went to North Georgia University. And the Dodgers paid the bills. And how that works, just to give you a quick background, because a lot of people don't know this. In baseball, a lot of players are signed out of high school. And to entice players to forego their college scholarships, because a lot of them are partial scholarships, they'll offer you a full scholarship. It's usually the value of what school you're going to and how much money that school is. Now, that's negotiable, and you can negotiate that number. So I got the amount of money Clemson University would have cost me at the time of graduating high school, and I got that money set aside, and that money has to be used for college. And I paid the bills for college, but then I turned around and sent them to the Dodgers. The Dodgers reimbursed me. So that's something that I don't think is done as much in other sports, just because other sports kind of use the college levels as their minor leagues, where baseball has this minor league system underneath all the teams, all these different levels to reach the major league. So it's just something that is a little bit different than other sports that maybe people don't know goes on as much. So 4 years later, I graduated with a business management degree from the University of North Georgia. During that time, I was coaching high school baseball. Coaching travel teams, working at an indoor facility in Georgia, which is very big as far as just youth sports in general, and the amount of families, the amount of kids that are at all these high schools is very large, just because of the city and where everybody lives. And according to the city, we live north of the city, and a lot of involvement in sports, a lot of involvement in money spent in their children to play sports. And so that was something that I did for a while, and then I had my degree in hand. I was doing the coaching, and it was something that where I missed the professional game. I missed being involved in a professional game in some way. I reached out to everybody and anybody that I could just to kind of get my foot back in the door, and I didn't really know what capacity I wanted to get back into. I looked into coaching a little bit at the professional level. I looked into scouting a little bit at the professional level, and the scouting seemed to fit my lifestyle a little bit better at the time. Meaning I had three kids. I didn't want to pack my bags up in February and not come home until September, as most coaches do, and really have to have their families come see them. But with scouting, which that allows me is what I'm doing today, and I'm going to get more into, was the ability to come home. So I do travel a lot now, but I certainly can come home every 5 days, and it worked out with the area and the teams that I have for my family to come with me a lot in scouting. So I say all the time that as long as the hotel has a pool, as long as they get some treats at the game, that they're all in and they're all for heading out on the road trip. So, but we're going to leave a question and answer at the end. I'm just going to get into scouting real quick now, because I know a lot of you have a lot of questions about what I do now, and as far as the scouting aspect. So I'm a professional scout for the Los Angeles Dodgers. So the Dodgers have three main scouting departments. They have an international scouting department, which is exactly what it sounds like. They're scouting overseas in Europe. They're scouting overseas in Asia. They're scouting in Dominican Republic, Panama, Venezuela, all the Latin America countries that a lot of these ball players come from. Their job, they're spread out all over. A lot of times they'll hold camps at the I know somebody that's in Barcelona, Spain right now, and they're holding a camp, which is for all the prospects around not just Barcelona, but a wider net. Down in Dominican, the Dodgers have a facility that they own, which you can sign at 16 down there and then live at this facility. So these 16-year-olds from the Dominican Republic and from Venezuela and other Latin America countries are living at this facility where they're taught English, they're playing baseball, they're given better nutrition, they spend usually a couple years at these academies before being given an opportunity to play then in the United States. So just so that they're not brought from their country and saying, here, go live in Yakima, Washington, they're kind of ease into that transition that they're about to encounter. We then have the amateur scouting department, which may come to Greenfield High School, which came to watch me play. They are going out to find the next big thing. They're going to watching high school games, college games for the draft in June. So I'm not sure how many. I know there's a set limit of rounds. There never was a set limit, but now there's a set limit of rounds. But there's 40 rounds. The Dodgers are going to draft 40 players. They're hoping that 40 players sign, but realistically, some of those say, no, I'm going to go to college, or no, I'm going to stay in college. But they're drafting the next wave of people, and then after the June draft, they're off to the next year. They're finding the next year's big thing and trying to have that inside edge of finding all the talent that's eligible for the draft. Oh, thank you. I looked thirsty, didn't I? And then my department is the pro scouting department, and we scout players that have already signed professional contracts. So I'm going to be scouting this year in Gulf Coast, which is for your first year players from the Dominican coming over, players that were just drafted in June, players that maybe were drafted last June but didn't make a team out of spring training, all the way to the major leagues. So obviously more of my time is spent watching minor league players than it is major league players, because there's only two major league teams that I'm responsible for, but I'm responsible for all the teams underneath it. So the two teams that I'm responsible for are the Toronto Blue Jays and the Boston Red Sox. Now the Boston Red Sox are a new team for me this year. Some of you don't start quizzing me on the Red Sox players because some of you in this room may know them better than I have. But the Blue Jays, I've had, this will be my fourth year of the Blue Jays. I'm very familiar with that system and all the players in their big league team all the way to the minor league teams. And if the Dodgers are ever matched up with a trade with the Blue Jays, or if I think the Blue Jays have a surplus at a certain position, I'll send it along to the Dodgers. Or maybe they have a need at a certain position and I know it matches up with the Dodgers' surplus, then maybe there's a trade that can be made before the two teams. So what will happen this year is I've already spent a couple weeks in spring training. The teams that I had in spring training were the Yankees and the Blue Jays. I've covered the Yankees the last couple of years, so I'm familiar with their organization. And then now, once the baseball season starts, I'll have 19 teams overall. So I have all the Blue Jay teams, all the Red Sox teams, and four extra international league teams, which is AAA. I have to see all those teams for five games each. And the reason I see five games, and specifically five games in a row, is if I go in and see five games in a row, then hopefully I've seen everybody on that team. Because most teams have a five-man pitching rotation, so I see every starter. And then within five games, you usually see every bullpen player. You usually see the backup catcher play at least once. You see the infielders, the outfielders kind of sprinkle in. And so some of my views on a player will certainly be more comprehensive than others, but I'll at least lay eyes on all 25 players. I wish it was easy as just going and watching the games and then doing a phone call. It's not. I then have to insert all 25 players that I've just seen for those five games and write a report on every one, whether I like them or whether I don't like them. And that's the one part that I don't like about scouting. But there's got to be something that you don't like about your job. I think everybody has something that they don't like. So that's the one thing I don't like, is just getting on that computer. People always say, oh, you know, you get to go to all these cities, you get to see everything. Well, I do get to go to all the cities, but a lot of times I see the inside of my hotel room, because if I am away, I don't want to bring that work home with me. When I get home, I want to be home and done with work. So a lot of time is spent on the computer during the day and then going to the games at night. I'm usually working on the team I just saw while I'm watching the team I'm currently seeing and getting caught up and backtracking. We use a 2-8 scale, two being and I'm talking about like a role player, somebody that fits our minor league system but probably isn't going to ever make the major leagues. Realistically, I don't know what the percentage is. I remember my coach, my very first year in Yakima, we have 25 guys, and he was trying to motivate us because we weren't doing very well, and he said, look around the room, two of you are going to make it. And we, you know, this is, you know, we had all just signed professional contracts. We were all the big fish, you know, wherever we came from. There was number one picks. And he was being realistic where he said, look around the room, two are you going to make it? And I have to go into these cities, 25 guys, and I have to be realistic about it as far as, like, you know, which ones stand out. Which ones do I think are going to make it? Which ones have the edge over the others and why? And so when I'm writing out these reports, the twos are the people that belong here, belong in the minor leagues, but they're probably never going to make it. The threes are the ones that are going to fill in for maybe a couple weeks at a time, disable list. You have to go on the 15-day disable list. This year they made it 10. Which players can kind of fill in? Which players are going to be at Pawtucket waiting for their opportunity to come up and throw a couple innings but then get sent right back down again? Your fours are your role players, on maybe your bench players, not your everyday starters, but they are good enough to have a bench role. They're good enough to be in the bullpen and throw an inning here or there. Your fives are your average major league player, which I know that sounds bad, average major league player, but those are pretty good players. So when I say average major league player, like, even though you might put you might put a few, like a grade, I might put a two on a player that's in rookie ball, but I'll say like a future five. Like if he couldn't fit into the major leagues right now, he's a two, he belongs in the minor leagues, but I'll put future five, meaning I think he's an everyday major leaguer. And realistically, there's really not that many fives. Just because, like I said, there's two of the players in that locker room are going to make it to the major leagues. Your sixes are your all-stars, the people that are going to make an all-star team, the people that you hear about, the people that get the fans excited on the team, because probably diehard Red Sox fans still probably couldn't name all 25 people on the Red Sox. You know, maybe all of you said you can, but it'd be surprising if you could. And then your sixes are your six. That's your sixes, your all stars. Your sevens are you're going to recognize and walking down the street. And your eights are he's in the Hall of Fame. You know, your big poppy, you know, the larger than life player that's just better than everybody else at what they do. So I bring that grading scale with me into each series and assign a number on all the players so that when we go and do trades, we're matching up. You know, like what the Dodgers think that their number four is for a Red Sox number four, so that they can kind of balance out their roster. When, you know, just, I don't want to bore you, and I know we're running out of time because I want to make sure I leave plenty of time for questions, but the grading scale out of players 2 to 8, and then on their tools, there's five tools that I look for. Hitting for power, base running ability, arm strength, accuracy, and fielding ability. Those are your five main tools that I'm then putting kind of the same scale, a 20, which means very below average, to 80, meaning he's, you know, one of the best. So a guy that has the best arm in the major leagues, I'll take Puig, for example, in the Dodgers, his arm's right up there. You could give it an 80 grade just because it's better than everybody else. As I played with Vladimir Guerrero, he'd have an 80 arm. You know, he could pick up the ball in the corner, throw it to home plate, and be pretty accurate with it and get it there pretty easily. Where the guy that, you know, needs two cutoffs would be a 20 arm. So obviously, like, you know, a lot goes into it as far as, you know, your right fielder needs that above average arm. Your first baseman really doesn't. Your first baseman needs to be able to hit for power. You know, there's different categories that kind of fit the position and fit the bill when you're going into it. So I'm going on and on. I need some questions before I kind of just bore you to death. But some of you may have known all this, some of you didn't. I appreciate you being an attentive audience, but the first question is always the hardest. Who wants to ask maybe the first question, just as far as just baseball in general? Who wants to talk about baseball? Who has a question?
Go ahead, in the back.
Yeah, so the question was if we have a separate rating for catchers. So we don't have a separate rating by position, but we would grade them. Their fielding rating would be how they receive the ball. Their throwing rating would be their time to second base and their ability to stop the running game. And so with catchers, like I said, more emphasis is given on certain things. So the big tool now is being able to receive and how at the major league level they're trying to make that measurable with computers and how it's how many strikes they can get called that maybe are out of the strike zone. Our catcher Yaz is ranked very high and it's called stealing strikes. So maybe catching a ball that's out of the zone but presenting it in a way that it looks in the zone. So that's something that the technology isn't there at the lower levels, so we have to kind of do it with the naked eye type of thing. How well does he receive? And that would go into his fielding grade. What is we time from the point where the ball hits his glove to the point where the ball hits the glove at second base when a runner's stealing? And that time computes to a rating where five would be it takes him 2 seconds, that would be five, that would be medium. And then anything under 2 seconds would be above average, which would then get a 6, 7, or 8 grade. So the scale is the same, but emphasis is put more on receiving than it is maybe on their hitting. So each position is ranked as far as so a catcher would be receiving, throwing, and then it would be more like hitting and then hitting for power and base running would be at the end because you really don't need a fast catcher. So like even if they're a two runner, it really doesn't matter because they're a catcher. So that doesn't come into play. So it's not going to affect their overall grade just because they're graded low at running. So there's another question in the back. Did you have a question, sir?
You've been memorably wrong about
the prospect. What was the question?
Have you been wrong about the prospect in a memorable way?
Yeah, for sure. Like, so this is my fourth year, and so like, I was laughing all the time when I first started out, like my first year, second year. I'm starting to get to my fourth year, so now, like, but yeah, there's a paper trail in all our reports that we leave. So certainly, like, my first couple of years, I could always say, well, just give him time, he needs time. But now going into fourth year, if I wrote somebody off, certainly, like, that could come back to bite me if he makes it. But Gary Sanchez, good example. I wrote him up as a backup catcher. And who's to say that maybe he will or will not be a backup catcher, but I remember writing my report that he struggles with the slider, more of a platoon role. He can spell Brian McCann against lefties because at the time Brian McCann was a catcher. So I'm doing, Gary Sanchez is the catcher for the Yankees this year. He went off at the end of last year. He was Babe Ruth at the end of last year. So far this spring, he's Babe Ruth again as far as hitting home runs. And you know, I'm saying he's a backup catcher. You know, he's capable of being a backup catcher, but he can't slide or anything else. And he's certainly someone that's proving me wrong right now. So, certainly, yes, we're wrong plenty of times. And like the one thing that I guess the reports do is we have to put in why we put a certain grade on. So I could go back and say, you know, at the time I put Gary Sanchez wasn't hitting right-hand pitching sliders. So now if he's doing that, it certainly changes his game and it would change the report that I would write at present day because he's made that adjustment. Yes?
So when you were, say, in Harrisburg, have you seen your own paper trail? What they thought of you?
So,
and this is a two-part question here. The second part is, answer the first part first.
So I run into a lot of scouts. So I run into a lot of scouts that scouted me, that were with, you know, that scouted me through high school. They're now professional scouts or sometimes amateur scouts will do some pro games, especially in their area. After that June draft, they'll do it for a couple months. If there's no big tournaments that they're seeing, they'll kind of do some lower level stuff, the even big league stuff, just because they have to recalibrate. You think about an amateur scout, they're seeing high school players, they're seeing college players through the whole summer for the most part, but they grade on a pro scale. Like when they put a 5 on a college player, that's supposed to be major league average when they're doing all that. So amateur scouts do pro coverage also after the June draft to kind of recalibrate to say, you know, hey, this is what a 5 is really supposed to look at. So everybody remembers me as being a guy who could run fast. That's the first thing I get all the time. And certainly, like, I've never seen an actual report written up about me. But, you know, just looking back at my career, like, you know, I was that guy that, you know, maybe I was a 4 coming up and that guy that could be on the roster, but, you know, kind of turned into a 3 because I was up and down a lot. So that would be the number that I would give myself.
The other thing I'd like you to do is talk about some of your coaches and who you especially liked as a coach and why.
The first name that comes out is Ron Reneke. He was my double-A manager in San Antonio. And the reason why is because he pushed me. Number one, like I was supposed to make that double-A team out of camp. He's someone that fought for me to be on that team. And it was just you know, reason I say it wasn't supposed to be on that. I spent a year at low-A. The natural progression is to go then to high A and not go to double A right away. He's someone that fought for me, but he's also someone that challenged me through the whole year. I was known for speed and defense. I remember distinctively Tulsa, Oklahoma.
I caught a ball by the wall, made the catch, everything else. And he didn't show me up during the game or anything, but after the game, he called me in the office and said, nice catch, and kind of leading on, did you drift on that ball? And looking back, and what that means is just, not get to a spot, not get behind it, not catch it the right way. And I said, yeah, I guess I did drift on it. And he said, I know you're better than that. I know you can get to that spot, even though you caught it. I want you to progress. I want you to be the best out there you can be. I want you to get back behind the ball, even though there's no runners on, even though no one really said anything. It was just a challenge, like truly not take things for granted type of thing. And so like that's something that, really kind of just stuck with me. And as soon as you asked that question, something that kind of went in my mind. So, I've certainly had many coaches along the way, but that's just one thing that sticks out in my mind. Yes.
As a player, did you enjoy offense or defense more?
Well, I was better at defense, so maybe everybody likes to hit. So certainly, growing up, I loved playing shortstop. They always say that infielders that aren't good enough to be infielders but are fast enough, they're outfielders. The infielders that aren't good enough that are slow become catchers. A good friend of mine, Michael Barrett, we joke all that because we were both shortstops in high school. He became a catcher, I became an outfielder. So neither one of us were good enough to stay in the infield, I guess. But I certainly love defense. It's something that I took pride in. But I like the challenge of hitting. So hitting certainly was something that I had to continue working at. It didn't come as easy as defense, just instinctively. But I think just hitting's more fun. It's more engaging, especially in the outfield. Sometimes you got to trick your mind into staying engaged where, when you're hitting, you're, all eyes are on you. It's you versus the pitcher type of thing. So I think, hitting is probably my favorite, but I was better at defense. And I know hitting's my son's favorite because he never wants to play the field and he'll never pitch to me. All he wants to do is hitting. So I think it's like that for a lot of people. That all they want to do is it's kind of hitting first for you. Hitting first and kind of defense second. But certainly, defense is an important part of the game.
He said he'd pitch to you if you want.
Yeah, he'll pitch to me finally, yeah.
I'm a much better defender.
You're a better defender? So is defending is more fun for you or do you like to hit?
I like to hit, but it's better.
Yeah, so I think we all naturally like something that we're better at, but it's hard not to like hitting. You're right involved in all the action. So even though you have a Giants hat, I'll call on you.
I have an Expos hat and I didn't wear it. First of all, this is awesome. Thank you so much. I have a million questions. Some might have to wait until after. But I'll ask the first one, the most fitting one, because we're in a library and your mother was a librarian. Have you ever read Prophet of the Sandlots?
I have not read Prophet of the Sandlots.
You should totally read that. It came out in 1990 or 91. It's about a scout. It's bittersweet, but it's hard to find, but there are four in the C.W. Morris. You should totally read that.
Okay.
Second, to some of the questions that are being asked, so you were a center fielder. Did you have any trouble evaluating pitching is very different from evaluating your regular everyday players. Mm-hmm. As not a pitcher, did you have to kind of learn more about pitching? And which is harder for you, and in general for scouts? Because it seems like sometimes, pitchers.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So, going over our department, so there's some people that never played professionally that are scouts. But our department is kind of a mix, and a lot of times, when we're evaluating a player, if it's a pitcher, it's usually always the scouts that were pitchers are asked first, and if it's a hitter, vice versa. Great advice given to me by a former coach that I had, who's now a scout, because he was a position player, and I was having a harder time evaluating pitchers than I were hitters for sure, and. He said, step in the box, pretend you're in the box, and then use your experiences as a hitter, what makes this pitcher good, what doesn't make this pitcher good, and I work at it from a standpoint where what's the ball doing at home plate, and then work my way to the pitcher. And pitchers, I think, are more apt to do it the other way because they can break down mechanics a lot better than I could because they've had the coaching from the different pitching coaches. They've had maybe they're a better evaluator if this guy can get better than I would be because, oh, if you just change this or change that. Where I'm more as, you know, what does the ball do at home plate? This guy would be tough to hit. I don't really care what is, you know, his arm angle is or if he could change something to get a few miles an hour. I'm looking at it as a hitter standpoint, this guy's tough. I wouldn't want to face this guy. And so certainly over the years, I feel like I've gotten better at evaluating pitchers, but I'm probably harder. And if that makes me a better evaluator, I'm not sure, on position players and swings and defense and stuff like that, what they can do on the base pass and stuff like that, just because it was more my game and more what I was coached through the years. So, yes?
Peter, if I remember right, you had a pretty decent hitting streak with the Expos early in the season. By the end of the season, you were having trouble hitting. Was the difference from the beginning to the end something in you or something in scouting reports? Or to what would you attribute your ability to hit early in the season and then inability to hit later in the season?
Right. I think, like, consistency in a player is huge. And I was very streaky. And so that's, unfortunately, not something that major league teams want. They'd rather know, you know, like, so if I'm going to hit 240 for the season, they'd rather have me hit 240 from day one to game, you know, 162. That way they know what they're getting throughout the course of the season. And when I was either way up or way down, which would drive a manager nuts, which would drive the scouts nuts, the front office nuts, and everything else. So as a lot of times when I'm scouting that type of player, that's a three, the guy that could go up and down, get him up while he's hot, send him down while he's not, type of thing. And so like that hitting streak, you know, that, like, I think it was get up to like 16 game hitting streak during that year. But like you said, I mean, at the end of the year, is, you know, I have a career 226 batting average, which isn't going to give you 10 years in the big leagues if you keep that. What contributed to that, I think just hitting was tough. It was something that I constantly had to adjust, something I constantly had to work at. And, you know, everybody becomes a better hitter once they stop playing, of course, right? And so, like, you know, looking back at it now, I wish I had made certain adjustments. But just at the time, it was just that cat and mouse game where the pitcher makes adjustments to you as a hitter. Can you keep up and make that adjustment to the pitchers and to the scouting reports? And what's out there on you, built up each day. Yes?
I'm still playing in a couple of men's senior leagues.
Okay.
Just today I bought a new bat. Do you have any, do you know about these Axe bats? Mookie Betts' advertising, mm-hmm. Have you tried one?
Yeah, I've seen them. When I was coaching down in Georgia, people were having them. I think the concept is there. It's really hard. Obviously, Axe bat is more of like, just the handle is different. For those of you who didn't know, like, instead of like the traditional round handle, it's a handle like you would get in an axe. And the thought behind it is it's kind of chopping down and through, just get your hands in a different way. You know, some of the players, I think just like anything, it's changed. So players that never have used it, they're not going to like it. Players that maybe used it as they've been coming up, they're going to love it just because they're used to it.
I started using the pro hitter thing, you know, that little, when I saw a couple of guys in the pros using it, I said, well, I'll try it. I liked it, so now I'm going to try
it. There's certainly, I mean, there's so many different ways to hit, and I have to be conscious of that as a scout, just because, even as a coach, you know, sometimes you'll look at a younger team, and every kid hits the same way. And you're like, well, that's how the coaches hit.
Yeah.
Because everybody hits the same way. And then you go watch the Red Sox, and it's hard to find two people hit the same way. And I really think, you know, players, you really have to give them the freedom to, you know, if they want to use that Axe bat, just because it's not something you use, you can't, like, discontinue the use of it. Just, oh, I didn't use that, so you have to hit this way. And as a scout, just because it's not something that I grew up doing myself or anything that I've really heard of before, if somebody wants to stand with their hands wave above their head, that's fine, as long as they lead to some success and as long as they get to some certain spots that they need to get to be a successful hitter. So there's so many different ways to pitch and hit and play the game of baseball, and that's something that makes baseball so great. There's so many different like positions on the field for different body types, for different skill sets and stuff like that. For if you're fast or slow, you can still be on the same team because not everybody has to be fast on the field. Not everybody has to be the power hitter on the field. You might throw a knuckleball, and that's different from throwing 95. So that's something I love about baseball. It kind of brings everybody together to form this team. Then you put it all together, and you have this finished product. So. Yes.
As a kid, did you have, did baseball ever feel like a job? Did you have trouble balancing life in general
As a kid, definitely not. As a kid, I just loved being active. I loved being out playing. I can remember. I remember days where it was like preseason football practices were going on during the day, and then we'd have a Legion game, and then I'd play like a summer basketball game right there on Davis courts. I think I did that only a couple times, but played three different sports in one day. As a kid, I couldn't get enough of it. It's certainly a job. In professional baseball, there's certainly, there was days where, I maybe didn't want to go to work. Maybe July 4th, I wanted to go to a barbecue instead of going to play a baseball game. You don't really get days off once the season starts, but if that ever kind of came into my mind, it was like there's a lot worse things that could be going on. There's a lot worse things that I could be doing than going to the ballpark to play baseball. So even now, as a scout, I love what I'm doing. I get to go watch baseball games for a job, but there's certainly days now where if I'm missing one of my kids' games or something like that, it's still like just like anybody else who has a job in here, there you have to try to find that balance for sure. Yes.
Do you have a most memorable hit, and do you have a most memorable fielding play?
The hit would be either my very first hit as a major leaguer at Olympic Stadium in my first game. I hit into a fielder's choice. My very first at bat, my knees were shaking. Swung at the first pitch, ground ball to shortstop, and there's a guy on first, so it was a fielder's choice, so I beat it out at first. They didn't double me up. And then I walked a couple times, and my last at bat, I got a hit into left field. So that's probably you can't beat your first hit. The only thing that maybe could beat my first hit was getting hit off Pedro at Fenway Park, just because it was Fenway Park. And so the hit went off the Green Monster in left field. Was something that, as a kid, hitting it off the monster, over the monster. And so getting a hit at Fenway off the monster was probably pretty, right up there, with the first hit. Fielding play, I don't have any cool home run, saving. In Montreal, the fence was so high, I couldn't even get to the top of it. So I wasn't robbing any home runs in Montreal, but I don't know. I guess I don't really. Nothing really stands out as far as my best play ever. So I don't think I ever made Sports Center for I was known as a defensive outfielder, but I don't remember anything that just stands out that was better than all the rest. So sorry, I don't have anything cool there. So. Yes.
How often do you coach your staff with Dodgers meet?
So the question was, how often do we meet as a group, the pro scouting staff, and then how often do we talk with the general manager with regards to trades? So we just had a meeting in spring out in Arizona. We usually, when we get together, it's at our facility in Glendale, Arizona, and that's where we have our spring training. So we meet once in the spring, once at the before the trade deadline, so right around the All-Star break, just to go after targets that we're going to for July 31st is the trade deadline. It's the last day that teams can trade with each other to make players eligible for the postseason. So we meet before, in the middle of that month, begin the middle of July, to say what we're kind of going to be going after at the end of July. And then we meet again in the fall. So three times is how often we meet in person. And that's usually the only time that we ever interact with each other, because we're all assigned different games. Sometimes it works out that we're at the same game, but very often it doesn't. So it's just kind of by chance if we actually meet up at the same game. So I'm at a game with a lot of scouts, but none of them are Dodger scouts. They're scouts from other teams. And then the next question was, how often do we meet with the general manager? Andrew Friedman is the president. He makes a lot of the decisions with the help of our general manager. Our conversations are with our boss, our pro coordinator, and then he kind of brings the information to him. So it's kind of changed. I don't talk to Andrew about a certain player, but I'll talk to my boss about a certain player if something's in the mix. A lot of it's done on email. A lot of it's done through just reading the reports. They may call and check up. You still good with this report? This is the report that we're going off of with this player, with this trade. And he'll just say, do you need to tweak anything? Is this where you still stand? Have you seen him again? Type of thing. So I'm sitting with other older scouts, and it used to be they would check in every couple weeks with the general manager. These are the two that I like, and then they hung up the phone. And there wasn't, you know, as many reports to do. There wasn't as much discussion. It was just more of a trust basis. But now there's so much. Not only is the general manager using our reports, but he's using research and development reports and all the new StatCast information that you can get from readings on velocity and how often do they take a pitch, and how, you know, exit velocity on hits and launch angles and stuff like that. So computers have really overtaken the amount of information that's available, so that the general manager can use those reports also.
You had a front row question over the corner.
Sorry.
Of all the major league parks that you've played in, best hitter's park, best pitcher's park?
Let me try to think. So Philadelphia and Coors Field jump out as best hitter's park. It really does travel in Colorado, just as far as you know it as a hitter, just in batting practice, ball it's carrying. My first career home run was at Coors Field. A lot of people gave me a hard time saying that didn't even count because it was at Coors Field. But my first home run was there. But even as an outfielder, and just out west in general, those higher elevations, a lot of cities, even in the Pacific Coast League, AAA, as an outfielder, you know, you think you're over the, you know, you're under the ball, and it really does carry a couple extra feet depending on the hit and stuff like that, just because of the higher elevation, the thinner air. But Philadelphia was a really good park to hit in also. The ball just seemed to really fly through there. It seemed like as far as pitcher friendly, Chicago early in the season when the wind's blowing in and it's cold, you have no chance. Chris Bryant maybe can do it, but I remember going to Chicago early in the year, and just when Kerry Wood was there, Mark Pryor, and facing these flamethrowers, and it's freezing out, and the wind's blowing in, it's like, you know, how am I expected to get a hit today? So, and I probably didn't. So, those would probably be, whenever it's like cold and wind's blowing in, that's the worst for a hitter.
Yeah.
Yes.
What's the highest scouting grade you've given, and who's the best player you've scouted, or is that might be a secret?
I love watching Josh Donaldson play. So he's with Toronto. So I certainly like Toronto and New York are the teams that I've had the last couple of years. He's my favorite player to watch. You talk about like five tool players, a guy that can do the five tools that I mentioned well. He does all five above average. And, I don't think he gets enough credit on how good of a base runner he is. Maybe he doesn't have a lot of stolen bases, but he'll always take that extra base. He has the arm, he has the fielding ability at third. He's one of the best fielders I've seen over there. and the power speaks for itself because of the amount of home runs he hits every year. But with two strikes, he can get a base hit the other way just as easy. So he certainly is someone that I probably put my highest grade on, and someone that I really just I enjoy watching him play. And he's someone that has a reputation of maybe rubbing people the wrong way over the years. I know he's got the reputation in Oakland that he fought with management a little bit and stuff like that. But he's someone that I would want on my team if I was playing. Yes.
I just want to bring you back around to Janice. If you hadn't had the parents you have, doubtless you wouldn't have gone to a professional athletic career, right? How important is it to have parental support and educators behind you?
Yes, certainly. They drove me to all the games. My dad's back there, and so my dad and my mom, they never said no that I couldn't play a certain sport. They never said no, we can't get you there, or can't get you to practice. Never said no if I wanted to go in the backyard and play and stuff like that. So that's something that certainly is important. And my mom, when I got, she was torn because when I got drafted, and it was either go to college, and we said earlier on that how important education was to her, or go to professional baseball. I think she was especially afraid that, you know, I was just going to become some meathead and go off to professional baseball and my world gets turned upside down, and unfortunately in athletics and in sports in general, you hear so much about the bad people because they get the headlines more so than the people that are doing good. So I think just...
Well, that was another thing. I'm thinking of, Bull Durham and things like that, the way baseball players are portrayed in the movies.
Right.
Not necessarily complimentary either.
Correct.
And they get a lot of the attention, but by and large, the tribe that you run with is a worthy tribe, I would think.
Certainly, and a lot of it has to do with the upbringing. How you're brought up, if those values are instilled at you at the younger age, they're not going to be influenced easy at an older age. And certainly my parents, they raised me right, so I was able to stay on that good path. And so with my mom in education, and when I said that I was going to college later, she was thrilled, certainly that I was taking that opportunity. And she's someone that... She took college classes whenever she could. I don't know how many people know that, but if work would pay for her to go take a class, she would go and take. She took classes online. She went to UMass. She kept on trying to get more and more degrees in the nursing profession, and it wasn't necessarily because she was going to get a bigger paycheck, but she just always strived for more knowledge.
Had a curious mind.
Yes, she certainly did. Well, yeah, a couple more questions, and I know we said we were going to try to wrap it up over an hour, but I'll ask a couple more. I have no plans today. So.
Do you have any recommendations for travel teams nearby?
Well, see, travel teams are tough. I don't know this area as much. Certainly, if you're playing baseball, you're doing well. So, people that spend a lot of money to be on travel teams when they're 13, 14, I think it's beneficial for sure if it's a good coach, if it's a good group of guys, if you're playing a lot of games. But I think you can also get that without spending ridiculous amount of money. I know the travel ball scene in Georgia very well just because I was involved in that for many years. I don't know the travel scene around here as well, but if you talk to me after, if there's some questions that you have specifically for a travel team or what to look for, then I can certainly maybe put you in the right direction. But it's just really playing baseball. Biggest thing, if you want to get noticed, your summer of junior year, so after your junior year, and I know some people are starting even earlier with recruiting, maybe sophomore season is starting to get a little bit more important, but that's when colleges scout players. Colleges don't necessarily scout players that much during the high school season because that's when the college seasons are going on. They have their own season. It's hard for them to get out and recruit. So summertime is the biggest recruiting season for colleges. Don't be afraid to reach out to colleges and give them your schedule show them interest, go to camps at college campuses, because that's something that they can then talk to you if you go to the camp. There's so many rules about when they can talk and when they can't, but if you go to a camp, they can then talk to you. And then the senior year, baseball during the high school season is when you're going to get scouted mostly for the draft by professionals, because that's the June draft. They want to see what you are right now. So those two times, that's when you have to make sure you're on a team, that you're being exposed, that you get your name out, and show interest. Show interest. I remember writing letters to all the professional teams saying, here's my schedule. I went to pro scout workouts. I went, you know, I told you I went, drove to Ohio as a junior. That was my summer junior year. Went to this big tournament. So just getting out there and playing is the biggest biggest thing you need to do as a player. Yes.
Thanks, Peter, for coming down and giving us really interesting speech. The question I had was, you mentioned about your interest in football and baseball in high school, and I remember at that time in your senior year that there was a lot of talk about whether you wanted to go into baseball or whether you wanted to go into football. And then I went down to that Holyoke Greenfield game where you got injured. I still remember your mother running around the field, you know, just trying to see, make sure you were all right. But you got injured that day, and it was shortly after that you seemed to, I heard all the talk stopped about whether you're going to go baseball or football, and centering on baseball. Did that injury have anything to do with making up your mind that this is, I know you said baseball was the biggest interest for you, but when you're deciding on something like that, so young.
Yeah, the question, if you didn't hear, the question was just, you know, why baseball, not football? And I wasn't, my last football game, I was injured. I broke my collarbone. And that injury didn't have nothing to do with it. It was like, I loved going and playing baseball every day. Like, I love, if we had, you know, if I was, you know, going to practice baseball, you know, if I had to go to practice every day, no games, I would go to baseball practice every day. Like, I just love playing baseball, whether it's practice, games, whatever. With football, I love games. I didn't necessarily like the practices. And not that I was being lazy and, like, didn't like the hard work. I loved the game of football. I loved playing in games. I didn't have the love for it like I had the love for baseball. And maybe some of you can understand where I'm coming from. You know, you do something, you enjoy it, but just something else, you enjoy that much more. And so, like, you know, if I'm on a baseball field, I'm never looking at my watch, saying, when are we done? And maybe I was doing that a little bit in football, like, you know, how much longer do we have? So I certainly loved football. I loved that I played football, but I had a bigger love for baseball. And so I signed early for baseball to kind of take that pressure off. And I never really went officially through the recruiting process, just because I had an opportunity with Clemson. It just felt right, and it's something that I truly knew that's what I wanted to do.
Yep. This will be my last one.
Okay.
I think you gave very good advice to the young kids about playing more than one sport, because I think there has been more and more and more specialization, and like focusing down because, oh, I'm going to make it, like playing year-round. And there's been a crisis in baseball with pitching as far as kids blowing out and needing surgery more and more and younger and younger. Is that a thing? Are you tracking like, oh, this kid, even though he's only 20, he's thrown a ton of innings already, or that's not even a...
Well, like, so it wouldn't be something that I'm tracking.
Uh-huh.
I'm saying what... I'm giving what I see now. So like when I go to a park, I'm seeing what I see now, what I think he become. But certainly that number is out there, especially if they're from college, because
right.
those innings
yeah.
are more
right.
available and then professional baseball than maybe a high school kid. That's certainly something that follows them.
And it's a concern that they're pushing like pitchers too far too much early.
Yes, yeah, for sure. In this year, the Dodgers have a player that is good enough to break with the team, and he should be in the starting rotation, but he's young, they're being careful with him, they're kind of holding him back so that he'll be there at the end of the year, and they're controlling his innings, and I think you see more and more of that. players coming off of injuries, younger players that make it up really quick, controlling the amount of innings. And in the minor leagues, they certainly control it. Guys usually don't throw back-to-back days in the minor leagues where guys on the Red Sox are expected to do that, especially, you know, Kimbrel will throw maybe 3 days in a row and then he'll get a rest, but even then it's like, man, do we really want to rest him or we got a chance to save this game? Where in the minor leagues, it's, you know, they back off. They're really...
It's college that they're...
Yeah, they're college is... It's tough too because sometimes with college,
coach wants to win
because it's a business just like anything else. And I think some college programs see the value of rest, see the value of protecting their assets long term, even if that doesn't mean for them. Where other colleges maybe they don't look at it that way. Yes.
It sounds like you were really good ball player right from the beginning. Can you think of anything that you had ever struggled with that you had to work through or? How you work through it?
Well, like I said, certainly, you know, hitting was something that it's just hard. It's hard to hit. There's no doubt about it. Like, in a lot of times when they list hardest things to do in sports, when they open it up to any sport, hitting is right there at the top. So hitting is something that I always continue to have to work on and something I had to specialize in. I was blessed with good speed, but it's something, even though I was blessed with good speed, it's something that I continue to work on. It's not like, oh, I'm fast, I don't need to work on that. You certainly, if you have a tool, whether that's a good arm or good fielding or good speed, don't just throw it out the window and say, oh, I'm already good at that, I'm going to focus on these things. You know, try to use what you're best at to the best of your ability so that you can be better than everybody else. And going back to if I'm a shortstop and I'm a really good fielder, you don't necessarily have to work on the power part of your game because you need to try to be the best fielder that you can be. Or we talked about the catchers and the different roles. You know, a catcher's not going to work on their speed. They need to be the best receiver that they can be. So it's really finding what you're good at and maximizing that rather than, hey, I got to try to be better at this and then maybe not as good as you could have been with what you're already good at. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I got it. Real quick question.
Okay.
Are you still faster than your kids?
Yes.
At running and at reading?
I would say.
I see a big thing.
Oh, yeah. So I think that they definitely challenge me. They definitely like the race. I think I can still take them, but I yeah, but I know we could go race right now. Is that weird? But no, I'm actually like my knee is messed up right now, unfortunately.
Oh yeah.
And just like everybody's got like that injury that slows them down, so they might be faster than me right now.
And reading, who reads faster?
Who reads faster? Well. I have a kindergarten that's just starting to read, so I think I can beat him in reading. No, they are all coming along really well as readers and trying to show off their reading ability and their progression on the levels of books that they're reading and stuff like that. So they're getting better and better every year.
Let's have a big hand for Peter.